sense to me.
Well, yeah, it's not too sure. It's very hard, but obviously.
If you got a receipt book, I said, in case somebody signed up, most of them aren't signing up, they're just paying. You know, I pretty well know who the members are.
The receipt book, so the Virginia's got a receipt book.
Oh, you're here.
I have one. Have you got a receipt book?
It was
have you got a
big article in the
sheet. Very good.
Playing the
sheet. Oh, sure
about it.
Yeah, don't
you
think we should
do it together? To different groups. And we had our eye on it because it's much bigger than our own place. And we need a bigger place to meet.
We were expecting that because I've been very, very involved with the visitor has the established a mission territory. So I've been involved in the organization.
I would like to also say to, at this time, if people in the audience have suggestions for any other subjects or lectures that they would like to see as part of our series, please see me or some of my committee members. I'd also like to thank at this time, while I have all your attention, a few of the people that have been, that are part of my committee, and you know, things don't happen unless lots of people help, and I find that with this particular committee, I have some wonderful people that are helping. Mary Constantine, Tony Gajowski, who did the visuals for our speakers today, Gina and Florence Vasilidis, who have been taking tickets, Annie and Ron Wood, who have loaned us some of the equipment, Trifon Hytus, who is the operator for the video today, and a number of other people who are part of the society who are out there helping in other ways. We are videotaping the lecture today so that we will be able to take orders for the video afterward if you so desire. And we also have videos available at intermission for a past lectures and the banquet that we held last year. We'll have coffee and books and cards and membership available at the intermission. And there will be a 15-minute intermission between speakers. Now, for our first speaker. Our first speaker has made a journey from Boston, Massachusetts to the Anglican priest to a congregation in Toronto. And is the congregation which is the only English language Orthodox church in Toronto among 30. He served for 10 years as an Anglican clergyman in Canada and the United States. He was ordained to the Orthodox priesthood in 1980. From 1980 to 84, he was Orthodox chaplain at the University of Toronto, where he was encouraged to form an English language Orthodox congregation by the 15 people that were received into Orthodoxy at that time. Since 1985, Father David has been rector of the St. Joseph of Arimathea Parish. Although no longer an Anglican, he says that he is still a missionary at heart. Father David Feldin.
I'd like to thank Virginia for those remarks and make some remarks of my own. I'm very grateful to be invited by Virginia Evans to give this talk, originally entitled Orthodoxy, a Historic Perspective, but according to the flyer, Orthodox Theology, or What You Have Always Wanted to Know About Orthodoxy. So I'll leave icons, at least Macedonian icons, to Georgi, and who follows in the second talk. This is rather a tall order, I think, for an hour or less. And when my talk was reviewed last week, I found it necessary to chop here and cut there, especially if we were to include the fine slides produced by Tony Gadzowski. So if it seems a bit disjointed, please remember that it is two subjects, history and theology together. It's a good thing I believe in holy obedience, because after I heard the recommendations of the panel of three or four who reviewed my talk, I began an extensive process of simplifying and editing. You know, we priests often take for granted that the laity know more than they do, especially when the priest is a convert who is talking to a largely born Orthodox. So please, no question is beneath me. And furthermore, I suggest that you interrupt me if you have a question, rather than waiting till the end of the talk when you may have forgotten your question. I can't guarantee that I have all the answers, but I can try. Questions like, why do we make the sign of the cross differently from the Roman Catholics? And why do we use crowns in the marriage ceremony? And similar questions could have an entire separate talk devoted completely to Orthodox practice and customs, but we will entertain any question from the floor. And I can't help mentioning the marriage crowns without thinking of the first Orthodox marriage I performed with heavy Russian crowns. Not like the Greek ones, you know. These weigh 10 pounds a piece, or it seemed to me. And in crossing them over the head of the bride and the groom, I managed to give the groom a bloody nose. Fortunately, it was only the rehearsal. So, the purpose of this talk is not to bore you with a dry historical survey, but to mention the history of the church within some aspects of her theology, and in a way that will be relevant to you, that will bring you right up to date. There is not much more that we can do in such a short space of time, so don't be afraid to interrupt me. I'm not talking from memory, but have the complete text of the talk in front of me. So with that, we can dispense with the lights and have the first slide. It was the late Dean of St. Vladimir's Orthodox Theological Seminary in New York, Alexander Schmemann, who coined the phrase, Orthodoxy, the best kept secret around. Well, it is not for want of trying that we are attempting to change that. On the feast of St. Joseph of Arimathea, July 31st, according to the church calendar, 1985, the first and still, as far as I know, only all English language Orthodox parish of more than 30 in Toronto came into being with the blessing of the then Archbishop, now Metropolitan Vitale of Montreal, and Canada. I die in the faith of the Catholic Church before the disunion of East and West, and more particularly, I die in the communion of the Church of England as it stands distinguished from all papal, Roman Catholic, and Puritan Protestant innovations, said Bishop Thomas Ken of Bath and Wells in 1637. That's Bishop Ken, who was a famous bishop of the Church of England. Assume that you were hearing about Christianity for the first time. To know something of Christ, you would need to read the Gospels. Maybe you would go back and study the prophecies to see how and why Jesus is the Christ, God and man. You would look at the New Testament to see the beginning of church order and development. You would read the early church fathers, for example, St. Irenaeus, and later St. Basil, St. John Chrysostom, and others. And then you will see how the various doctrinal controversies were settled by the entire church gathering in seven great ecumenical councils. This is an icon of the first ecumenical council. In fact, the Orthodox Church has often been called the Church of the Ecumenical Councils. This will also give a clear picture of the doctrine, discipline, principles of the faith, plus a clear picture of the form, nature, and shape of the church. Look around the world and decide where you can identify these norms and standards. It is wishful thinking for Bishop Ken to insist, quote, I die in the faith of the Catholic Church before the division of East and West, unquote. Granted, it is prayerful wishful thinking, for had he in fact died in the faith of the Catholic Church before the division of East and West, he would have died an Orthodox Christian, for, quote, the Church of England as it stands distinguished from all papal and Puritan innovations is the Reformed Church of England, whereas Orthodoxy is never reformed because never deformed. And it was that faith which was brought to Britain by St. Joseph of Arimathea shortly after the resurrection of Christ. But Orthodoxy itself, what is it? That is the subject of this lecture. The Orthodox Church goes back to the very beginning of Christianity. The name Orthodox means right glory or right worship in Russian, pravoslavny, not right belief, as is mistakenly thought. However, the two are closely linked. If I want to know what the Church believes about God, the Holy Trinity, the Incarnation, the Church, the Mother of God, or anything else, I will find the expression of these beliefs in the worship of the Church, in the text of the liturgical services. This is why it goes without saying that the worship of the Church must always be in a language which is understood by the worshipers. St. Cyril and Methodius, apostles to the Slavs, realized this when, under divine inspiration, they translated all the services from the original Greek into Slavonic, and even invented the Cyrillic alphabet to do it, basing themselves on Apostle Paul, who says in 1 Corinthians, yet in the church I had rather speak five words with my understanding, that by my voice I might teach others also, than 10,000 words in an unknown tongue. If we do not even understand the words of our worship, brothers and sisters, we will know nothing or next to nothing about our faith. But we will come back to this. Beside the worship of the church, the faith is also revealed in iconography, music, architecture, the writings of the Holy Fathers, and so on. The name Orthodox applies to the sister churches whose faith is expressed in the seven ecumenical councils and who are in communion with one another. Recalling the times when the various patriarchates, although the latter is not always the case, recalling the times when the various patriarchates have fallen into heresy. The famous heretic Nestorius was patriarch of Constantinople before he was deposed. We recall the words of St. Maximus the Confessor a few centuries later, quote, when the patriarch of Constantinople returns to Orthodoxy, I will return to the patriarch, unquote. And though the whole world enter into communion with the patriarch, I alone will not, unquote. Thus we see that to be in communion with a historic patriarchate is in itself not a guarantee of Orthodoxy. At first there was no Eastern or Western church, but only one Catholic, meaning universal or complete, not to be confused with Roman Catholic. One Catholic and Orthodox Church, they're one and the same thing, meaning right worshiping or right believing, as we have just said. And this is what we call ourselves to this very day, Orthodox Catholic Christians. By the grace of God received at Pentecost, the apostles established the church throughout the ancient world. St. Paul founded the Church of Antioch. St. Peter and St. James, the Church of Jerusalem. St. Andrew, the Church of Constantinople. St. Mark, the Church of Alexandria. St. Peter and St. Paul, the Church of Rome. These, then, were the five great historic patriarchates. By degrees, two of them became more important than the rest, Rome and Constantinople. Rome, because it was the imperial city, and because its patriarch, the Bishop of Rome, or Pope, claimed direct apostolic descent from Saints Peter and Paul, and Constantinople, which under Emperor Constantine became the new imperial city, the seat of government for the Roman Empire, the new Rome. When the emperor left Rome for Constantinople, his temporal authority gradually passed to the bishop of Rome, the Pope, who now alone stood for order and tradition in the western part of the empire, abandoned to the barbarians from the north. Constantinople, meanwhile, quite naturally became the great center of the East. These two great sees were in perfect accord in fighting down heresies and in compiling the Nicene Creed. All the ancient patriarchates remain Orthodox to this very day, with the exception of Rome. But please note what I said about the falling into heresy of one or the other at any particular time in history, and that it is not necessary to be in communion with all or even any of the patriarchates in order to be Orthodox. The saying has come down to us, Athanasius contra mundum, one man against the world. When practically all the bishops, except for St. Athanasius the Great, had fallen away from the Orthodox faith.
Father, excuse me. Could you explain to us what this purpose of the slide is?
This is the spread of Christianity at the time of the fall, the end of the Roman Empire. So the end of the Roman Empire, this is the extent of the Christian world. The New Testament reveals that the church had her share of problems. All was not perfection. And if we can say that of the New Testament church, should we act so shocked and scandalized when we said the same thing about the church of the 20th or the 21st century? This has always provided a handy excuse for those who do not want to be committed. But in spite of this, there was growth and maturation. Even as the church was attacked from within and without, the same spirit who gave her birth gave her power, and she stood strong and grew, eventually invading the whole of the Roman Empire. We must remember that the church was founded at Pentecost, and that the church was there before the Creed, before the Gospels. In talking to Protestants, one gains the impression that the church came out of the Bible, and that the Bible fell from the heavens in the King James Version, no less. But the truth is exactly the opposite. It was the church in council, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, which determined, of the many writings at hand, which were to be counted as canonical scripture. The church put the Bible together. Non-Orthodox do not seem to realize that if it were not for the early Christian church, today called the Orthodox Church, there would be no Bible. In those scriptures, we are taught to stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by our word or epistle. 2 Thessalonians 2. St. John Chrysostom writes, quote, "This tradition of the church is not only in the written documents, but in unwritten form. Until the New Testament was written, the early Christian community abided by oral tradition." St. Basil the Great says that the tradition and ancient custom have exactly the same significance as written dogma. According to his Canon 91, quote, "Of the dogmas and precepts which are observed in the church, some we possess are derived from written teaching, others which we have received have been delivered to us in a mystery by the tradition of the apostles, and both of these in relation to true religion have the same force. And this no one will contradict, no one at least who is even moderately versed in the institutions of the church. For were we to reject such customs that have no written authority on the ground that the importance they possess is minor, we should injure the gospel in its very essence," unquote. Orthodox Christians believe that the teachings of their church are those of the first apostles and disciples of our Savior. These teachings have been handed down through successive generations to their own day. Some were recorded in the scriptures and other writings of Christian teachers. Others have been handed down by oral tradition, or as we said, are found in iconography, music, and architecture. Sola Scriptura is not the teaching of the Orthodox Church. when St. Paul speaks of the traditions which you were taught, whether by word or epistle, he referred to living tradition. Orthodox spell the word tradition with a capital T, not the dead traditions of men. Scriptures, creeds, sacraments, councils, apostolic ministry, canons, holy fathers, saints, monasticism, all these and more form living tradition. Of course the scriptures, the written word, form the core and the center, but living tradition includes all the rest. St. Paul says, by our word or epistle. Orthodoxy has never exalted tradition above the scriptures as have the Roman Catholics, nor has it placed tradition below the scriptures as have the Protestants. Rather, as I have said, the written word is at the very heart of a living tradition. Remember how the Gospel according to St. John ends, quote, there are also many other things which Jesus did, the which if they should be written, every one, I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written, unquote, John 21. But some books were indeed written. We call these works apocryphal writings. While they do not have the strength of the scripture, all that is good and true in these writings have been absorbed by the church. There is no need for us to search the Apocrypha in the same way we are commanded to search the scriptures, Acts 17. For example, we have three feasts of the Mother of God in Orthodoxy, her nativity, her entrance into the temple, her dormition or falling asleep, called in the West the Assumption, all based on apocryphal writings, which combined with the patristic commentaries on them, iconography, hymnody, all taken together convey what the church believes about the Mother of God. The word patristic means pater, father, of the fathers of the church. The point that I'm trying to make is that for generations the Christians lived by oral tradition and the writings of the early fathers. The church existed before the New Testament. It was the church that put the New Testament together, sifting through many writings, excluding some totally, such as the spurious Gospel of St. Thomas, while with great discernment in council under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, defining the canon of the scripture. Thus, sola scriptura, or scripture only, could never be the claim of the Orthodox. It is the living tradition of the church that for 2,000 years, the fresh new insights of women's liberation and radical feminism notwithstanding, has called men and women equal but different. The Mother of God is the highest pinnacle of God's creation, but was not one of the 12 apostles. The priests and the bishops are the successors of the apostles. We do not ordain women as priests and bishops simply because our Savior did not. Yet the argument we hear most often after, quote, there is nothing in the Bible against it, unquote, is that our Savior was culturally conditioned by his times. Therefore, since women held such a low position in his times, he could hardly do otherwise. We forget that our Savior broke out of his cultural conditioning over and over again. He was the friend of women when Jews would not speak to women who were not family members. The Savior conversed with a Samaritan woman at the well. It was our Savior who said, the Sabbath was made for man, not man for the Sabbath, and who broke all the rules and regulations of the Pharisees. How can we say that he who is the Lord of time, Jesus Christ the same yesterday, today, and forevermore, is culturally conditioned by his times, unless we really do not believe that he is the Lord? Yet he never made a woman, not even his mother, an apostle. And we are instructed, quote, stand fast and hold the traditions which you were taught, whether by our word or our epistle. And quote, withdraw from every brother who walks disorderly and not according to the tradition which he has received from us, 2 Thessalonians 3. When it began to make women bishops and priests, I withdrew from my denomination, believing that after 2,000 years it began to walk disorderly and not according to the tradition it received. No, women are not called to be apostles, but they are certainly their equal. In Orthodoxy, men and women are equal, but have different roles. And he himself gave some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers, Ephesians 4. Many women saints are called by the church equal to the apostles. St. Mary Magdalene, St. Olga, St. Helen, St. Nina, and others. If Orthodoxy is patriarchal, as I have heard it referred to, it certainly is also matriarchal. Not only do we have the fathers of the desert, we have also the mothers of the desert. The Western Christians, be they Catholic or Protestant, seem to have forgotten their church history. The great medieval abbess, St. Bridget of Kildare in Ireland, and St. Hilda of Whitby in England were rulers not only of their convents, but of monasteries of men as well. They had authority over both men and women. Orthodoxy has always recognized the role of the spiritual eldress as well as that of the elder. If someone was known for spiritual leadership, male or female, monk or nun, layman, laywoman, the faithful were encouraged to seek that person out for confession and direction, and only then to resort to an ordained priest for the prayers of absolution. In some places today, not all priests are empowered by their bishops to hear confessions. Laymen, laywomen fill this role. The West has forgotten her church history, for this has not been her experience since the division of East and West. A reading of the history of Orthodoxy through women's eyes showed the important place women saints, martyrs, preachers, evangelists, ascetics had in the life of the church. Women preached the gospel and fought alongside men to defend the faith from non-Christian invaders. For example, whenever Orthodox communities found themselves under occupation and the open practice of the Christian faith was not permitted, women assured the continuity of the church by teaching younger generations at home. Even today, in Orthodox family life, a mother is or should be instrumental in teaching the faith to her children. Women saints, martyrs, evangelists, ascetics have inspired women as role models. Women saints are an important part of holy tradition. So far, the ecumenical movement has categorized Orthodox women as a conservative group, unresponsive to change. It is time for the ecumenists to learn more about Orthodoxy so that they may know how wrong they have been. I'm sorry if I have seemed to labor this point, but in these days our holy religion is held up to ridicule as being backward and ultra-conservative by those who do not know the facts. For the first 1,000 years of church history, the entire church, save for the heretics dealt with by the ecumenical councils, embraced and defended the New Testament apostolic faith. This one faith, preserved through all attacks, trials, and tests, was called the Orthodox faith. It is perhaps one of the major catastrophes of Christianity that East and West fell apart. The advance of the Muslim Empire was partly responsible for this. During the end of the Byzantine era, for nearly 500 years, it claimed Eastern Europe as its own, engulfing millions of souls and parting them effectively from their Western brothers. As the first millennium drew to a close, numerous factors were working to separate the church East and West, but two major causes ultimately emerged above all others. That one man, the Pope of Rome, considered himself the universal bishop of the church, and the addition of a novel clause to the church's creed. For the Orthodox, all bishops are equal. The Patriarch of Constantinople cannot come to Toronto and tell the local bishop what to do. At a meeting of all the bishops, the Patriarch of Constantinople would come first. We call this a primacy of honor, not of jurisdiction. Orthodoxy rejects the idea that one bishop, any bishop, has more authority than any other. St. Ignatius of Antioch, whose icon you see, said, "Where the bishop is, there is the Catholic," meaning universal church. There is a complete church where the bishop, his priests, his people are gathered together. Patriarch, archbishop, whatever, are titles of honor, possessing no more authority than bishop. Orthodoxy also rejected the insertion by the Pope and the Western Church of the Filioque clause into the Creed. The Creed was formulated by the ecumenical councils of Nicaea and Constantinople to read, quote, "I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified," unquote. But the Pope added, quote, "And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son," Filioque. The consequence, of course, is in the Western Church has been to relegate the Holy Spirit to a lesser place than God the Father and God the Son. The change may appear small, but the consequences have proved disastrously immense. The crux of the matter is that one man, the Pope, changed the wording of the Creed without an ecumenical council, and for the Orthodox, nothing which has been established by an ecumenical council, including the Church's calendar, may be dissolved without an ecumenical council.
Well, you've been using the word ecumenical, but you've used it in two different contexts. You have ecumenical now, and you have ecumenical then. They're not the same, is that correct?
Well, ecumenical is a very good word, and what it means basically is it means the same thing as Catholic. It means universal. It means worldwide. It means, as you know, the Greek or koinome means the world, worldwide. So that is the good sense in which we mean ecumenical, and used in the contemporary sense of ecumenical, it means washing down. It means a watering down of everything to the lowest common denominator, you know, so that we can appease everybody, we can please everyone. This is the bad sense of ecumenism, the word ecumenical. So thus the Roman Church became formally separated from the New Testament or Orthodox Church. This is the briefest commentary on the historical facts, but the explanation of the breach between East and West is not to be found in history alone. Its causes lie much deeper in the nature and mentality of East and West, and in the different interpretations each often gave to the same belief. As the centuries passed, conflict continued. Attempts at reunion on Rome's terms always failed, and Rome drifted further from its historical roots. In the 16th century, the Western Church drifted further from its origins when it shattered into a myriad of sects at the Protestant Reformation. But remember what I said about Orthodoxy at the beginning of this talk? Never reformed because never deformed. While some Protestants, such as Lutherans and Anglicans, held on to certain forms of liturgy and sacrament, others, such as the Reformed churches and Anabaptists and their descendants, questioned and rejected many biblical ideas of hierarchy, sacrament, historic tradition, thinking that they were freeing themselves from Roman Catholicism. To this day, many sincere, modern, professing Christians will reject even biblical data that speak of historic Christian practice, simply because they think that such historic practice is Roman Catholic. To use the old adage, they threw the baby out with the bathwater. Thus, while retaining various degrees of truth, neither Protestantism nor Roman Catholicism can lay historic claim to being the true New Testament church. In a letter to her father, the Grand Duke Louis IV of Hesse and the Rhine, the new monarch, the Grand Duchess Elizabeth, the sister-in-law of Tsar Nicholas II of Russia, writes of the points of difference between Orthodox and Roman Catholicism and Protestant religious teaching. She was a convert from Lutheranism. One, the Orthodox Church recognizes as a source of divine revelation not only Holy Scriptures, but also Holy Tradition, which agrees with the Scriptures and is always recognized by the entire Eastern Church. The Church recognizes the ecumenical councils as witnesses to this tradition, which were assembled before the innovations of the Roman Church and the split of the latter from the Orthodox Church in the 9th century. Two, in the Orthodox Church, the creed without the Roman addition of the filioque, which teaches that the Holy Spirit proceeds not only from the Father, is used. Three, the Orthodox Church is the united assembly of all the living and faithful departed. The expression of this faith is found in the prayers for the departed and the prayers to the saints. Four, the Orthodox Church does not number the sacraments, as do the Roman Catholics who claim seven, and the Protestants who claim two, or the Anglicans who like to be in the middle and claim two great and five small. The Orthodox Church venerates the sacred images of Christ and the saints in churches and at home, which we call icons, not in order to worship them, but to be reminded of the example of the saints and to imitate them. The proclamation, six, the proclamation of the infallibility of the Pope and his absolute power and the dogma of the Immaculate Conception are not to be found in the Holy Scripture or Holy Tradition and are absolutely foreign to Orthodoxy. Seven, Orthodoxy has no head save Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, whose voice is heard in the ecumenical and received councils. What do we mean by a received council? It means the bishops can talk all they want to, but if they come back to the people, the laity, the people of God, with something that is far out, as they did at the Council of Florence, the people of God throw them out. As the bishop who returned from the Council of Florence, and the people asked him, how did it go? And he said, well, we all voted to join Rome. They threw him off the dock. Sink or swim, whatever he could do. That's ecumenical and received counsel. Eight, in Holy Communion, both the bread and the wine, the body and blood, are received by all. Nine, the clergy are free to marry before the ordination or to remain unmarried. Ten, the divine services are celebrated in the language of the country. 11. The Church strives to spread the Holy Scriptures in the language of the people. The Grand Duchess of St. Elizabeth became a nun after her husband's assassination, founding the convent of St. Mary and Martha in Moscow. She was later apprehended by the Bolsheviks and thrown alive into a well. Hand grenades were thrown down the shaft. The chanting of hymns was heard until it died away into silence. It was my joy and privilege to venerate the relics of the new martyr, St. Elizabeth, now interred in the Russian convent on the Mount of Olives in Jerusalem with Prince Philip's mother, whose aunt she was. Orthodoxy stands for unimpaired Christianity transmitted unchanged to us through the Church's holy tradition. It teaches that there is only one Church, one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church of the Creeds, namely the Orthodox Church. And while those who call themselves Christians may be divided, the Church is not, for it is one. While the Orthodox Church has been divided up into various national groups, Orthodoxy itself remains undivided. Philotism is defined as the undue devotion to and glorification of one's country or ethnic background, a prejudiced belief in the superiority of one's own race. Certainly, there is nothing wrong in having an ethnic identity. It is inescapable. However, when we manifest a greater allegiance to our ethnic background than to the kingdom of God, forgetting that our true citizenship is in heaven, we seriously err. This is, of course, precisely the mistake made by the Jews at the time of Jesus. They had come to believe that they had a special standing with God just because they were the physical descendants of Abraham. But as St. Paul reminded the Romans, he is not a Jew who is one outwardly, nor is that circumcision which is outwardly in the flesh. But he is a Jew who is one inwardly, and circumcision is of the heart, in the spirit, not in the letter, whose praise is not from men but from God, Romans 2. And yet, what do we find today? Hundreds, if not thousands, of Orthodox churches that are little more than ethnic conclaves dedicated to the preservation of that particular church's ethnic background. So in North America, we have Greek, Russian, Serbian, Antiochian, other churches that refuse to use English, even if it is the language of the country in which they dwell, and everyone in their congregation can understand it. I know there are plenty of congregations, especially in Canada, where people can't understand it. In complete opposition to the holy canons of the church, we have jurisdictional divisions based solely on ethnic heritage. We thus have a collection of bishops all competing for the same diocese. How can this be? Because they are trying to preserve something other than the kingdom of God. My first assignment after ordination as an Orthodox priest was to a very ethnically Russian parish, ostensibly for the purpose of introducing some English language work for the youth and for converts in particular. I remember one incident in particular in which a gentleman came up to me and addressed me in Russian, and when I apologized that I could not speak Russian, his response was, "What kind of Russian priest are you if you can't speak Russian?" I said, "Wait, I'm not a Russian priest. I'm a plain Orthodox. Just call me plain Orthodox." Now please don't misunderstand me. The heresy of philotism is not the preserve of the Orthodox at all. No churches could be more ethnic than some in which I have ministered beneath the Union Jack or the Stars and Stripes. But I am happy to say that in the church in which I have worshipped for the last 8 years, we have no flags. We are Orthodox first, and whatever else, second. In fact, every Sunday, the Creed and the Lord's Prayer are read after the English in a different language, the language of every single person who is represented in that congregation. One Sunday we have Serbian, the next Sunday Ukrainian, Greek, Russian, we even have Ethiopian and Italian and French and German, because the Orthodox Church, brothers and sisters, is for all men and women. The original church, the church of Peter and Paul and the apostles, despite the political oppression, carries on today the same faith and life of the church of the New Testament. In Orthodoxy today, as in years gone by, the basics of Christian doctrine, worship, and government are never up for alteration, as the apostolic ministry is, for example, in the Anglican church. One cannot be an Orthodox priest, for example, and reject the divinity of Christ, his virgin birth, resurrection, ascension, second coming, as we see happening today so frequently in the other denominations, even on the part of bishops. For Orthodox, the faith itself is unchanging. What St. Paul calls the faith once delivered to the saints is a given, but how the faith is expressed age after age can vary. The most obvious is in language. We have already mentioned how St. Cyril and Methodius translated into translated the Greek into Slavonic when no one understood Greek anymore. Now we have to translate Slavonic into English or whatever is the language of the country. Orthodoxy was brought to America by Russian missionaries from via Alaska in the 18th century. The first thing the missionaries did was to translate the Bible and the church services into the native language of the Indians. They didn't expect the Indians to learn Russian. They translated the worship of the church into the language of the people. And few people know that the Russian missionaries traveling south met the Roman Catholic missionaries traveling north from California, and the persecution of the Orthodox by the Spanish Franciscans resulted in the martyrdom of St. Peter the Aleut. In 1917, the Russian Revolution, destroyed the Russian Empire and plunged the Orthodox world into darkness. The church in Russia was subjected to vicious persecution by atheists. Patriarch Tikhon, whose icon you see here, anathematized the Bolsheviks and suffered imprisonment and torture for his refusal to submit to their demands. However, his successor, Metropolitan Sergius, gave in and with his notorious declaration of 1927, made the church in the Soviet Union a political tool of the atheist government. The majority of the clergy vehemently protested against this concordat, but was systematically killed. Not only the clergy, but Orthodox throughout the land suffered incredibly. According to the Soviet government's own statistics, there have been over 20 million martyrs who have suffered for the Orthodox faith, more than all the martyrs of the early Christian centuries put together. We can safely say that one of the remaining functioning arms of the KGB is the Moscow Patriarchate. In 1924, the Church of Greece, unilaterally, with no reference to the other Orthodox churches, adopted the Gregorian or Roman Catholic calendar. Of course, the issue is not 13 days. But by what authority does one church alter the faith without at least ecumenical consensus? You've already heard about this with regard to women's ordination. There are three irrevocable anathemas against any change of the church's calendar. Anathema means condemnation. There are three condemnations by the church in council under the guidance of the Holy Spirit of this change of calendar. These anathemas were pronounced by full authority of the fathers of the entire Orthodox Church in the 16th century, and hence cannot be revoked, not at least without another council. Bishop Gregory Agrabe of the Russian Church abroad writes the following: "It is not because of astronomical accuracy that we hold to the Julian calendar. The liturgical and dogmatic aspects of this matter are far more important. This is what is the concern to the Christian mind and the conscience of the faithful. The fathers of Nicaea, who put the calendar and its application to the liturgical life of the church on a firm basis, were granted wisdom by the Holy Spirit. Their divinely inspired work has passed into the tradition of the church. For 1,000 years until its deviation from orthodoxy, it was kept by the Church of Rome as well. Its loss of orthodoxy is revealed by its desire to alter the calendar," unquote. Moreover, we have already heard St. Basil the Great explain that the preservation of tradition and ancient custom have exactly the same significance as the preservation of written dogma in his Canon 91. The famous canonist Bishop Nicodim, in his interpretation of Canon 87 of St. Basil, says, quote, "Custom has the force of law in the church, so long as it has a basis justified by the church and if it has been sanctified by long-standing usage according to St. Basil. Brothers and sisters, Orthodoxy is like a beautiful tapestry or carpet. To remove one thread at a time, be it the calendar, fasting, the marriage of bishops, whatever it may be, is to reduce it to a pile of thread. The Julian calendar was accepted by the First Ecumenical Council of Nicaea and has been sanctified by more than a millennium of use in the church. For this reason, to abandon it or violate it is a violation of dogma concerning the church. It is understandable that the conscience of the Orthodox cannot be reconciled to this, and thus people who hold to it are abandoning bishops who have committed such a sin. Comparatively little has been published in English about the struggle of the true Orthodox Christians or old calendarists in Greece, Romania, Bulgaria, Russia, elsewhere. The new martyrs of the communist yoke have been known to the Christians of the West, and those who witnessed unto death for Holy Orthodoxy in Serbia when persecuted by the Latins a generation ago are perhaps less well known, but next to nothing is known about the witness of the new martyrs since 1924 for the church calendar, who contested not against atheists or against people who were traditional enemies of Orthodoxy, but against those who claimed to be Orthodox Christians, and indeed the rightful and canonical established church. And for that reason, I have brought a handout, the October-November issue of our parish newsletter, The Arimathean, which features the story of new martyr Catherine of Attica, the first martyr for the church calendar. Interestingly, in 1956, His Beatitude Dorotheos, the Archbishop of Athens of the State New Calendar Church of Greece, said, quote, "The old calendar movement is neither a heresy nor a schism, and those who follow it are neither heretics nor schismatics, but are Orthodox Christians," unquote. And more recently, Bishop Augustinos Kaviotis, an influential and outspoken bishop of the State New Calendar Church of Greece, has proposed that it adopt the old, or revert, I should say, to the old calendar, since, he states, the new calendar was uncanonically and improperly introduced. Orthodoxos Typos, May 26, 1989. Nonetheless, however sympathetic these individual pronouncements may be, persecution of those who follow the church calendar continues, if I may attempt to bring you right up to date. The Reverend Dr. Gregory Telepnev writes in the August 1993 issue of The Shepherd, an Orthodox publication from England, quote, "The old calendarists are not illegitimate. They invoke the canons of the church in resisting what they perceive as error in the established churches, that is, canons which require Orthodox to break away from their bishops, even those with the rank of patriarch, if those bishops deviate from the faith." Canon means a rule. Thus, the old calendarists consider Constantinople and the new calendar churches to be in error, for their acceptance of the Roman Catholic calendar, which has been condemned by several church councils, and for participating in the services of the non-Orthodox, which is forbidden by the apostolic canons, no less. Claiming that for the neo-papism, claiming that the patriarch is anything more than another bishop, and for the unilateral lifting of anathemas against Rome by the late patriarch of Constantinople, Athenagoras, something which can only be done by another council of the church. Because, brothers and sisters, our church is called the Church of the Ecumenical Councils. Nothing can be done without a council, and nothing that has been laid down by a council can be revoked without another council. So, by a general council of the church, only at such a time as Roman Catholics accept the dogma of the Orthodox Church and discard the doctrine of papal infallibility, the Immaculate Conception, and so on. Embracing the Orthodox as non-Chalcedonian Christians. Non-Chalcedonian means the Armenians, Copts, Egyptians, Ethiopians, Jacobites. All of these are people who broke with the church many centuries ago. And now Constantinople is trying to recognize them as fully Orthodox, as if nothing has ever happened, without trying to reconcile our differences. The issue of resistance is a distinctly Orthodox idea. When Nestorius sat on the throne of Constantinople, his errors of belief, despite his primacy of honor as patriarch, placed him outside of the church, making those who resisted him fully Orthodox. Legitimacy in this case lies in the hands of the resistors, and we Orthodox leave it to history to justify them. We do not calculate canonicity in terms of who is or who is not in communion with some established see. For us Orthodox, the truth finally vindicates godly resistance, and temporary separations, we hope, are nothing more than the process by which the church realizes its duty to purge itself of what is unhealthy and wrong. If, for example, over time, the modernist New Calendar Orthodox churches join Rome for political reasons, as did present-day uniates in the past, this will resolve the problem of the old calendar resistance. The modernists will have become something other than Orthodox, and the resistors will have maintained the faith. Only a church with apostolic succession, which in turn maintains communion with other churches if they have the same confession of faith, follow the canons and live in spiritual ethos of Orthodoxy, producing saints who reflect the enduring spiritual gifts of the church, is authentically Orthodox. Authenticity is ultimately determined then not by jurisdictional legalism, but on spiritual grounds. As the late proto-presbyter Alexander Schmemann of St. Vladimir's Seminary observes, quote, "For those who think that canonicity or legitimacy means that one has to be under some patriarch, canonicity is reduced to subordination," unquote. Indeed, the patriarchs, like all the bishops, must submit themselves to the traditions of the church. They express the conscience of the people of God only when they change nothing essential to the faith. If their pronouncements are innovative, as were those of the extraordinary gathering of Orthodox church leaders in Constantinople in March of 1992, then they are unauthentic. Indeed, the Patriarch of Jerusalem openly chastised his fellow leaders at this meeting for their criticism of Orthodox traditionalists, i.e., the old calendarists, and their curtsy to the powers of ecumenism and the Vatican, among which leaders were those subsequently exposed as KGB collaborators and dupes of other Eastern European secret police agencies, as well as suspected operatives of the Vatican. In the Orthodox Church, fidelity to holy tradition with a capital T, which includes a total and unequivocal rejection of papalism, fidelity to the precept that the Orthodox Church, while having a responsibility to embrace and aid the non-Orthodox, is the true Church of Christ, the criterion of Christianity, and absolute loyalty to those canons which forbid Orthodox to pray with the non-Orthodox, while requiring the Orthodox to pray for the non-Orthodox. These are the signs of legitimacy. They do not serve the desire of the Vatican to absorb the Orthodox into its jurisdiction, but they serve to protect the faith. To accuse the old calendarists of being non-canonical for upholding the faith, whether one personally embraces it or not, is appalling bigotry of the worst kind. At the time of writing this paper, I received the fax from Jerusalem, stating that the Patriarch of Jerusalem had been suspended, while two of his bishops and several of his priests had been deposed by Constantinople at an extraordinary meeting held there in the absence, of course, of the Patriarch of Jerusalem. Flying to Greece in order to defend himself, a warrant was issued for his arrest. Though he managed to elude the police and return to Jerusalem. We're not talking about the early centuries of Christianity, brothers and sisters, we're talking about last month. At the root of this episode is the retaliation of Constantinople for the above-mentioned chastisement by the Patriarch of Jerusalem, for Constantinople's harassment of the old calendars, for accelerating involvement in ecumenism, and further progress toward neo-papalism, of which this entire episode is a very good example. I would like to conclude this talk with two quotes, which sound very similar, but are actually 50 years apart in time. The first is by the noted English patristic scholar, the Reverend Derwas Chitty, who wrote in 1927, quote, "We must be warned that perhaps 50 years hence, when the great uniting church of Antichrist will be claiming to build the kingdom of God on earth, while the little true church universal scattered in small numbers throughout the world, feeble, sore smitten, maybe with its unity not everywhere revealed, shall be despised and hated." Unquote. And in 1977, Dr. Alexander Kalomiros wrote the following in his book, Against False Union, unquote. Quote, "But who will be able to recognize the Church of Christ in those small, scorned groups of faithful that lack all worldly splendor? Who, at the end of time, the one holy Catholic and apostolic church will be just those forgotten and outwardly disunited little parishes, which may even be ignorant of the other's existence, but will be united among themselves by the mystical bond of the body and blood of the Lord in the Holy Spirit with the common faith and tradition which they will preserve." In other words, brothers and sisters, if we think that the church is going to take over the world, we are sadly mistaken. The church is going to return to the catacombs in the last times, just as it emerged from the catacombs in the first times. I feel totally inadequate in trying to present you with the briefest history of the Orthodox Church from Pentecost to 1993. But I hope that with God's help, I have been able to throw a little light on the subject, and especially on what is relevant for Orthodox Christians today, no matter what their national background may be. In parting, I have to say to this particular group that our parish and our Canadian diocese and our church worldwide is aptly described as, quote, "the true church scattered in small numbers throughout the world, feeble, sore smitten, despised, and hated. But who will be able to recognize the Church of Christ in this small and scorned group of faithful, lacking all worldly splendor? I'll tell you who. The Macedonians. The Macedonians have been the founding members and backbone of our parish from day one, when we numbered 15 members meeting at Hart House, University of Toronto, to the 60 members of the present St. Joseph of Arimathea Parish, Toronto. At every service, we pray for them, the founders and benefactors of this holy church. These are those Macedonians who, with a few others, have had the vision of true orthodoxy. May their memory be eternal. Thank you."
Occurred to you perhaps when it, for instance, I wanted to know, how does a saint get to be a saint? We've got 365 saints in the Orthodox Church, some of which are women. How do they get to be a saint? What is the criteria?
any other questions as well. Remember what I said at the beginning, nothing is beneath me. No question is beneath me. So, Virginia, there's more than, there's about 365 saints for every day of the year. There are many, many thousands and thousands of saints. Those who are known to us, and those who are known only to God. And the ones who are known only to God are probably the more important than the ones who are known to us. So how does one become a saint in the Orthodox Church? It's not like the Roman Catholic practice of we have to find out how many miracles this person has performed, and then we can beatify him, and then we can canonize him, and a whole regular rigmarole. No, we don't have this practice. How does one become a saint in the Orthodox Church? It is by popular acclaim that one becomes a saint. When everyone recognizes that somebody is a saint, over the years, this may take centuries, or it may take a matter of months, or it may take a very short period of time. By popular acclaim, all of our saints in the Orthodox Church are recognized by the people. Again, this is a question of Orthodox ecclesiology in which everything comes from the bottom up. Nothing comes from the top down. So this is how one becomes a saint in the church. Any other questions?
Father, most of the people in this room are of Macedonian heritage, and I would suspect that most of them trace their roots to the northern part of Greece. So the question I have I'm posing to you is this: why has the Greek Orthodox Church been so consistently against minorities in Greece from hearing the word of God in their native language? And why does this attitude persist to this very day? And is there any hope for change in the future regarding this?
Well, I have to tell you that, I'm a former Anglican minister, so I'm rather not clued in on these topics. But I'll give you some interesting information, and that is, when I was a newly ordained priest, I went to see the local Greek bishop, who shall remain unnamed, perhaps. Because I have a wife and three children, and I had given up my career and my livelihood in order to become Orthodox. We all came to Orthodoxy as a family. And I went to see this man, and I said, Bishop, would you have any work in English for me? Because I don't speak Greek, and I don't speak Slav of any kind. And he said, I'm sorry, Father. I'm sorry, our church is only for Greeks. So this gave me a good indication that I was headed in the wrong direction, until I heard of a priest who left the Greek diocese. He left the Greek diocese, a very successful priest, who built a successful parish in Toronto. He left the Greek diocese because of this, and he started the first parish of the old calendar church in Toronto. And you know what he told me? He said, Father, you don't have to be a Greek to be with us. You want to be Orthodox? You're welcome to be with us. You don't need to speak Greek. You don't have to become something that you cannot possibly be, you know? And I found myself having to return to the old calendar church in order to be accepted as an Orthodox, because the others are concerned with something else, but not Orthodoxy. I hope this may partially answer your question. And we have been very, very happy in a place where the only concern is the Orthodox faith. No Greek, no nationalism of any kind. We don't have any politics. We don't. Obviously, I'm not going to join a church which is, I'm only interested in the faith. I'm not coming to a church which is harping on some kind of national identity or a language or, And I get very mad at the Greeks, even in the old calendar church, because they don't understand the language of their worship. And last week somebody came to our English church and said, "Father, I've been a chanter in the church for 30 years, and this is the first time I have ever understood the service." So, you know what St. Paul says? "I would rather speak five words with my understanding than 10,000 in an unknown tongue." So brothers and sisters, you know, I'm proud of my national identity. My ancestors came over on the Mayflower, and I'm the first one to have lived outside Boston in 300 years. I'm proud of my national identity, but not at the expense of the Christian faith. I'm sorry. Faith comes first. God comes first. Everything else comes second. So please don't confuse these two issues, and don't use the church as a means for teaching your language or ethnicity. There's plenty of opportunity. I'm so happy when people speak more than one language. I wish I could. I wish I could speak more than one language. My mother-in-law, who is, I'm American, you know, my mother-in-law, who is Canadian, says to me, "You don't even speak English. You don't even speak the right English." So, brothers and sisters, you know, as long as we're proud of our ethnicity, we're proud of our language, of our customs, of our ethnic identity, I certainly am, and we should keep these issues separate. Don't use the church as a means for conveying these things. Supplementary, of course, complementary, but not uniquely.
I'd like to introduce our second speaker, who is Georgi Danevski, who has been currently working on the St. Clements of Ohrid Church, the icons that are decorating the church. There was a spread in the paper about Georgi in the Toronto Star. You might have seen it outside. Georgi attended the High School of Art in Skopje. He was a resident of Skopje. Then after he graduated from high school, he went on to Ljubljana and the Academy of Art, where he took first place. And then for a couple of years, he traveled around Europe, Germany and Spain, and Italy and Poland, as an art student. Icons are just one part of his artistic endeavor, but today he is going to be speaking about the Macedonian icons. He's an artist in his own right, but the icons that that he will be showing you today are things that he's been involved in, and also the fact is that he is quite knowledgeable about Macedonian icons. He'll be speaking in Macedonian, but we will have questions afterwards. And Oli Belchevsky, for some of the people who maybe not, because Georgi does not speak English as well, he will translate for him, and so that everyone will be comfortable with questions. I'm not sure whether he would like to have questions asked of him while his lecture is on, but I think that certainly at the end, if something occurs to you, ask away, why not? Because after all, this is what the purpose of our lectures are, is to stimulate and to educate and to inform our people, and people that want to learn about our roots. Before I give the thing over to Georgi, I want to also let you know that we will be having another lecture sometime before the end of the year. And again, if you have some suggestions, we do have people in mind, but if you have some suggestions, please see one of us afterwards. And also next spring, we hope to have what I would call a danza corenia, a day when we can have an entire day of learning about our roots, about culture, history. We'll have a special speaker, and then we'll have a banquet at night. And instead of, it will be a kind of a fun day, but still also a hopefully we'll certainly put it into the paper, Peter's paper. And now I'd like to introduce Georgi Danevski.
Повързува една тема, това е Македония, и втората тема е християнският свет и цялата култура, що я дал, цялата култура, що я дал този свет на цивилизацията. И аз ще се обидам не да зборувам от история, тук да зборувам за настанувањето, за социологията на историското време и за самата уметнина, која настанувала во истото това време. Македонските икони, како појава, тие не се сами за себе. Тие припаѓат на еден поширок свет, а тоа е на светот на Византија. Јас би сакал уште од почетокот да кажам дека појмот Византија е нов појм. Тоа е сушност името на градот што го направил принцот таму спроти слепите. Додека источно-православниот свет го обединувала една империја, тоа била Роменската империја, така што ние себе ја викаме Византијската империја. Која е Македонија во тоа време и во тој свет и како значај има? Македонија сама по себе е порта на западниот свет кон источниот и обратно источниот од порта на источниот свет кон западниот. Според тоа, Македонија има голем значај и голем допринос во мостот на културите и на световите од античкиот свет, ромејскиот свет и до средновековието, се до паѓањето под турското иго во турската империја. Ние знаеме дека илјадници докази во македонската земја зборуваат за многу култури и луѓето кои го носат култивираниот дух, тие не велат, ете тоа мора да се наметне македонската култура на светот, туку велиме дека цивилизација со цивилизација се прожима и таа просветленост која давала Македонија со другите народи е општо светско добро и кое е подедовано на сите нации во светот како дострел во човековата култура и во стварањето на тој магичен свет, бидејќи културата е единственото нешто кое го победува времето и кое го бележи човековото постоење со светлост, а не со војни и со други деструкции. Каде е прапочетокот на иконата? Тоа е тешко може да се каже, бидејќи, како што реков, византискиот свет не прејдува чисто во византиски свет. Сушност, тоа е на настанување на крв и на оган се претучувала една ера во друга ера. Така, заморениот падански свет со големи жртви и со големи жртви на христијанскиот свет доваѓа до својата конечна победа која Константин Велики го прогласува христијанството првин како равноправна вера на другите, а потоа како главна државна вера. Со тоа паралелно секако се движела и уметноста. Колку може да разберам преска во дискусијата за меѓу христијанството, православното христијанство на македонска нација или на грчка нација, нешто еден термин историски се сега злоупотребува. Јас отворам книги, дали се штампани англиски, дали француски, и гледам дека православието се представува секогаш како грик ортодокс. Сметам дека тоа е неправилно затоа што би направил една компарација овде, реков дека нема да зборувам никаква политика, но само со културолошки докази кои ги оставиле многу луѓе со своето просветлено напрегање и со своите дела. Именно византискиот свет, како реално да го гледаме, тоа е свет на мултикултура. Во него има повеќе теми. Имате тема Мисија, имате тема Арменијака, имате тема Антиохија, тема Македонија, што значи живееле повеќе нации, но имале еден заеднички именител, а тоа е именител православието. Тоа е програмот на христијанската вера. Во почетокот земјата не давала доволно докази, бидејќи поминале многу хорди, поминале многу обнови, не сите тие земји каде што го представуваат денешниот базен на византиската империја или на православниот свет. Но сепак мајката земја полека открива и прапочетоци на таа голема цивилизација и големи докази на таа голема уметност. Јас имам чест овде да ви представам еден доказ. Ние ги немаме на диапозитиви, но јас донесов неколку прототипа. Ова се засега првите и најстари икони во теракота. Ова е Свети Ѓорги, Свети Кристофер, Аракангел Михаел. Ова се два старозаведни воина, кога Јошуа и Глеб, кога го закриваат сонцето и месецот, одејќи по патот за обеќената хананската земја. Ова е една илустрирана Давидова псалма, тоа е Атисот. И овде имаме еден детај, оштетена е теракотната икона, тоа е Теодор и Роман драконоубиец. Веднаш ќе забележите дека ова е дескриптивата, пишено е со убаво класично римско писмо. А овие икони беа една алка која недостасуваше како културна информација во христијанската цивилизација од два века, тоа е четврти и прелазот на пети век. И уште еднаш ќе кажам дека имам чест дека тоа се најдени икони, 40 или 50, од кои се капителци 20 и неколку, над 50 метра на моето студио во Македонија. Ватикан силно го проучаваше и беа изложени во Ватикан и во Третјаковата галерија како еден феноменален доказ дека македонското тло крие прожимање на повеќе големи култури и покажува дека ете, добиваме веќе два века информација токму нови во македонското тло. Што значи, веднаш треба да расчистиме со поимот дека се оно што пишува на грчки не значи дека е грчко. Ние знаеме дека во Византиското царство постои период на Латинско царство. Неколку пати се менувала. Сега како енглезите од овде да кажат, целиот свет е наш свет, наша култура, бидејќи енглескиот јазик се наметна во говорот на светот. Затоа, уште еднаш ќе потврдам дека ние треба опрезно и со чистост да пријагиме на светот на Византија, да не дека е тоа ортодоксно грчка црква, но дека се наметнале по некои случајности или под некои потрепи да го криво информираат светот дека се што е православно е грчко. Не е тачно. Втората златна доба на Византија е токму се јавува меѓу словенските народи. Јас ќе споменам, глад да не ја одвлечувам темата во историски аспект, ќе се вратам веднаш на самиот проблем на иконата. Иконата е сакрална света појава, каде човекот ни светиш, ни с љубов, ја исповеда својата вероисповест, ги пренесува во една контемплација внатрешните желби и внатрешната чистота кон Бога, за да ја услише Бог неговите молитви, за да му помогне, дали во болест, дали во љубов, но сето се однесува човекот со една благопокорност, да ја почитува високата Божја милост и секој пат да знае човекот дека некоја сила е над него. Прапочетокот на иконата, Светото писмо бележи кога уште во катакомбите. Катакомбите откриват тајни символи на Христос. Првата представа на Христосовиот лик е представувана како риба. Бидејќи ние добро знаеме, христијанството не носи само верски чувства во прахристијанството. Тоа е револуција во самата свест на човекот и тоа е го кинел првиот ланец на робството. Така се распаднале сушност и големите римски латифундии на рабовладетелите за християнството да ја одигра својата не само просветленост и големата социолошка социолошка револуција во историјата на човештвото. И да не ме чуди зошто толку моќно во нашата подсвест и во нашата внатрешна топонимија живее Христосовата личност, бидејќи тој асоциира првин на љубов, на слобода, на просветленост и на она се што е светло во човекот и се што е надежно. Така се обходувале и авторите, и уметниците. Тие се труделе да го творат сето тоа со чистота и фетиш, да зборуват за светото писмо, но овде и субјективната уметничка природа доваѓала до израз, бидејќи таа е продукт на здивот на нивните раце и на нивниот разум. Јас ќе споменам уште една династија која има врска со Македонија, тоа е Птоломејската династија. Таму негде во една оаза во Египет, во Фајум, се прочуените фајумски портрети. Ги споменувам овде затоа што се многу автентични на самата икона. Тие се работени на даска, на дрво, со обложена со платно, со восочни бои, тоа се вика енкаустика, и често пати си позлатувани. Нивната намена е всушност паганска, бидејќи ги покривале саркофазите на умрените, но тие зборуват со една силна естетика, зборуват со еден танчен вкус и всушност се хроника на времето и тие се сведоштват за носењето, обичаите, како живееле тие луѓе. Многу по форма, со благата стилизација, подсеќа на самата икона. Го споменувам тоа затоа што таму близу во Синај, во храмот Хагија Катерина, Света Катерина, тоа е еден од редките храмови кои иконоборството не го оштетува, бидејќи бил обграден во времето кога се јавува иконоборството со муслимански сили и така е поштеден, а бил значаен, Света Катерина е значајна, по тоа што за христијаните и евреите Моисеј ги прима законите од Синај, и за нас христијаните е важна затоа што моштите на Света Катерина се наоѓаат таму. А дека муслиманите, легендата вели, го почитувале затоа што кога се вознесол Мухамед, таму имало некое стапало на камилата од Синај. И ете, поради тоа останал нетакнат до ден денес да сведочи токму со неколку икони кои се доста стари, но не толку стари колку македонските деракотни икони. Тоа се предпоставува дека е негде 8-ми, 9-ти век, јас би ги споменал иконата на Свети Петар, Христос Пантократор и на Мајката Богородица со светителите Свети Георги и Ангели, кои се работени исто со истата техника, енкаустична како фајумскиот портрет. Ние секако во времето на Византиската империја, Македонија е многу близко до Константинопол и сите големи достигања, што уметнички, што информативни, теолошки, филозофски, веднаш доваѓале. Не случајно се Македонија е исто така голема тврдина на христијанството, на многу раното христијанство. Вие сите добро знаете дека Свети Павел два пати го гази македонското тло и сите негови посланија кои ги праќал до браќата македонци. Има уште други богомислители кои се многу значајни. Јас ќе го споменам Еразмо Охридски. Некаде неговото порекло е од Мала Азија, точно не се знае, но и тој е многу важен по Свети Павел за живата врска на христијанството од исток кон запад. Во Охрид има една негова пештера, има храм и тој е бил исто така архиепископ. Јас би сакал да дадам примат на овај школата што се раѓа во Македонија. Ние добро знаеме дека во самиот Константинопол има македонски ренесанс. Се вели македонски ренесанс затоа што некаде околу, не земете ме сериозно, околу 100-150 години владее македонската династија. Во таа династија има многу просветени владари кои давале голем стимул на уметноста и така златната доба на византиската уметност е токму во македонскиот ренесанс. Ја би споменал дека не се сликале само икони во, во цариградските работилници на, на даска со емулзија, со јајчена темпера, туку се правели и одрагоцени материјали, бидејќи фетишот бил голем према светите личности и се правило во слоновача, во емајл, во позлата и во разни други техники. Но интересно е што се случува по, во Македонија. Ние знаеме дека се во Македонија се случува една чудесна магија на примањето на христијанството. Тоа е 9-тиот век, кога светите браќа, Кирил и Методи, се браќаат од арапската мисија, хазарската мисија и одат кон уравската мисија. Но тие со себе ги понесуваат чудесните ученици, самочисениците, тоа е свети Климент, свети Наум, Горас, Ангеларија и Сава, седмочислени. Постои списоци дека постои уште еден, тоа е Севаст, се назира на една преска, но ние знаеме и ги викаме светите браќа со своите пет славни ученика, седмочисленици. Го споменувам тоа затоа што се ствара една, една духовна просветлена револуција во овие краишта. Така да мудроста и знаењето на ромеите, целата филозофија на христијанството, се преточува преку нашите предци, преку македонците. Од Солунско дори се тврди дека и јазикот со кој пишувале светите браќа е токму наречето на солунските словени. И со нив почнува грандиозната, грандиозната мисија на север, на север по Моравија. Ние го знаеме повратокот каков е на учениците. Кога свети Кирил умира во Рим, неговите ученици паѓаат во немилост, бидејќи тројазичниците, како ги велат, германите и латините, направиле притисок дипломатски и војнички, и така почнале да ги прогонуваат учениците на Кирил и Методија. Тие се враќат, но за среќа наидуваат на ново плодно тло и почнува еден голем, голем ренесанс. Јас ќе бидам краток и ќе го споменам каков е тој ренесанс, затоа што неколку нешто го придружува тој ренесанс. Тоа е прво големата едукација, големата писменост со првата охридска школа, со првиот охридски универзитет се предпоставува таква масивност дека немало тут тогаш во Европа, во, во раниот среден век. 3500 ученици свети Климент во Охрид воспитувал. Тој е првиот, станува првиот словенски архиепископ на чудесната Охридска патриаршија, која уште Јустиниан Прима ја створил. Потоа, пропратно со тој универзитет постоеле исто така и сликарски школи. И почнува големата ера и големата уметност, тоа е всушност втората златна доба на, на, на Византија. Преко на, на, на македонските, на седмочислениците, кои не би рекле дека ете, само за себе ги држиме, туку тие се важни за целиот христијански свет или пак за целиот братски славјански народ. Би споменал неколку храмови кои се бележити и се капителци на византиската уметност. Тоа е Свети Георги во Нагоричани, потоа Света Богородица Певелитерос во Охрид, или како што ја велеме Стар Свети Климент, Света Софија по својот ансамбл на чудесна и прекрасна архитектура, потоа би рекол уште два прекрасни мајстори кои се врвот на византиската уметност, тоа се Михајло и Евтихи. Тие ја сликале Богородица Певелитерос, Свети Георги во, во Куманово, Нагоричани и храмот на Свети Никита во близината на Скопје. Зачудува, јас ќе споменам една компарација, каква е уметноста на Западот, а каква е во Македонија и секако во, во, цел, во целиот византиски свет. Во Европа царува романиката, која не е така маштовита, доста скучена, доста темна, нема маштовито, се до појавата на готиката, ова е романиката, носеше известно стравотни чувства во, во самиот верник. Не ја љубеше светлоста, имаше згнечената фигура, така да кога ќе се погледат нашите, нашите цркви и нашите дела од нашите неймари, тие се суштинска светлост и суштински писар во светската култура. Тамо некаде сме биле на големо светско ниво. Тоа светско ниво, на жалост, трае неколку, два века, два и нешто века, и со довадењето на Турската империја спласнува, бидејќи сите тие аристократски школи кои постоеле, таа комуникација го изгубува значајот и почнува една не декаденца, но почнува една екзистенција на уметноста која не е зависна од желбата на луѓето да ја развиват во големини, туку просто да го задржат името, верското чувство, а секако и народното чувство, да не кажам национално чувство, затоа што поимот нација веројатно е покасен продукт, зашо нашите дедовци биле многу пошироки по дух, отуку, да речеме, сегашната балканска ситуација, која што ја гледате вие, или пак и светска. Јас ќе се обидам да кажам неколку збора и за моето творештво. Многу личности од Запад велат порано, не сега. Сега има едно ново отварање, едно ново планирање во суштината на византиската уметност. Тоа е сушност една голема античка традиција на, да речеме, на хеленистичкиот, на римскиот, на медитеранскиот свет, преведена во новиот програм на христијанството. Затоа треба секој пат опрезно да зборуваме за византиската уметност, да не тврдиме дека тие не го познавале тие рескурата, цртежот, затоа што на нив не им требала толку граматиката, да речеме, на светлото сенката. Оделе во една пропорционалност, но токму тие преко теолошкиот аспект сакале да ја добијат илуминацијата, да ја добијат изотеричноста на духот на христијанството. Значи, требало нешто ново да се даде, нешто поетично, и забележлива е прекрасната арабесна линија, која е многу синтетична и која е, заправо, има некои сличности, да речеме, со источнешките култури, како што е персиската миниатура, или пак персиската миниатура, кинеската лирска линија од кинеското сликарство. Светот многу повеќе се прожимал и се мешал, отколку што модерниот човек мисли за комуникацијата на светот во минатото. Има многу револуционерности кои уште модерното сликарство не ги уграбило или не ги искористило. Јас би рекол дека тој е инверзивниот простор, изокефалијата на големината. Тие се византиски, да речеме, мајсторите на православната уметност, се прекрасни мајстори на заклучената форма. Тие знаат добро да го употребуваат златото, за да се добие една метафизика. Во таа метафизика верникот да го направат како да учествува во самото библиско действие. Што значи, тука би рекол дека византиската уметност е една од редките уметности која има сила, која е многу снажна за да раскажува. Тоа е како целата сторија. Сушност, во почетокот таа настанува токму да го компензира литерарниот дел пред неуките маси на огромното распаднато западно римско царство и новото, кое источно римско царство, кое се стварало. Но инстинктот на авторите просто ги носел да тие ја кажуваат и својата собственост, својата субјективност во уметнината. Иако велеле дека ништо не е поголемо од Бога, и од почитањето кон Бога, но тие знаеле да си го остават својот ракопис. Јас ќе споменам неколку школи кои дале така чудесни мајстори. Реков веќе, една е македонската школа, исто така во Бугарија, еден манастир Бојана, Бачковски манастир, Студеница во Србија. Постои Јерусалимска школа, постои Антиохиска школа и постои она грчка школа, но нашите, словенските народи успеале да створат собствена школа и да бидат последната златна доба на Византија, може би и големата надеж на православниот свет до ден денес. Би сакал да споменам дека еден голем таткото на реализмот рекол Гистав Курбе, тој е француски автор, голем мајстор е тој кој знае стопати да направи една работа исто, да нема плод на случајност. Е, тоа се случува токму и со мајсторите на Источна православната школа. Тие во стотени пати повторуваат еден личен потеч, тоа значи тие имаат големи знаења, но нивните знаења се малку диферентни, не се како што, што ги прима, да речеме, западната цивилизација. Затоа треба секој пат да гледаме просветлено и со разбирање и на едните и на другите. Јас ви кажам неколку моменти за мојот однос, личен однос. Не ги спомнав само, ќе опростите големите мајстори, како што е Теофан Грек и Андреј Рубјов во Русија, како што е во Македонија Михајло Евтихијев, и безбројни многу автори кои го задолжиле, ја задолжиле светската култура и светската цивилизација. На некои ќе се откриват и нови имиња, светот пред нас таа загадочност тек ќе ја покажува. Ова е од храмот на светото, може малко да се... Ова е една од моите работи и мојот пристап, го почитувам канонот со сета негова предиспонираност, со без да го оштетам светиот дел, канонскиот дел на писмото, но сепак тражам пат за мојата субјективна личност, затоа што мислам дека ако човек во своето творештво не остава собствена трага, тој се утопува и паѓа во еден манир кој веројатно нема долго време да преживее неговата работа и неговото дело. Затоа мојот поглед на византиската уметност е до крај да го почитувам канонот, но да дадам една нова хармонија, да дадам еден субјективен однос на култивираност на психолошкиот портрет. Затоа овде ќе споменам дека многу големи мајстори знаеле да го почитуваат индивидуалното во портретот. Така да оците добри мајстори во светот на Источното православие, вие ќе видите еден третман на Свети Павел, дека тоа е различен ракопис, но дека безусловно го почитува неговата маркантност и неговата посебност на индивидуалноста на портретот. Или па, како што е Свети Петар, сега ќе го препознаете со белата снажна коса и со упечатливата снага, бидејќи тоа е еден најснажен од Христосовите апостоли. Овде го прикажува Христос Пантократор, каде што сакав да му дадам една хуманистичка, просветлена, ликовност. Затоа што и самото Свето Писмо позорува «Јас сум љубов, каде што љубовта, таму сум јас». Поради таа аксиома сакав да биде Христос не строг, туку да има една милозвучност, една пријатност во неговата психологија, во неговиот образ, за да се прожима, за да се спои, да речеме, со спиритот на верникот кој доведе и како верник, а и исто како културен човек да ја дегустира, да речеме, културниот дел на самата уметнина. Ова е Христос Пантократор од Скопската црква, каде што тоа е икона со прилично голема, околу 2 метра е незината висина од иконостасот на Свети Климент во Скопје. Тоа, тај просветлен хуманизм сакав и овде со живиот контакт да се спојува со самиот верник. Еве каков е односот на иконите. Овде понатаму ќе следува, ова е еден од најголемите иконостаси во светот, по димензија. Времето ќе каже како е, дали е квалитетен или не, треба да инкубира барем 200 години, па тогаш да се каже. Огромни димензии се чудесно мало време, за помалку од година дена се правеше, бев под притисок на време и колку може да... Тоа се, средните икони имат димензија 3 до 4 метра. Ова личност ја представува ова икона магичната личност на Свети Климент. Не зборуваме за него овде дека тој, Свети Климент, ете, ние спадаме нарцисоидно за неговата личност. Но да ги погледнеме во црквите во Печка Патриаршија, да погледнеме на Света Гора, во Бугарија, во Македонија, сегде се застапени неговите портрети, што зборува дека тој е маркантна историска личност. И може би, може слободно да се попалиме дека неговата големина не е само за нас македонците, туку да за сиот словенски народ и за сиот културен народ во светот. Зашто ги надминува границите на Македонија неговата големина, тој одеднаш во преведеното свето писмо ствари гениална поезија. Вие да ја видите само метафориката на проширеното житие од Димитри Хоментијан за светиот Климент. Или пак самиот Климент, кој пишувал за житието на свети Кирил и свети Методи. И како куриозитет, директно во Ленинград постојат неколку листови од лично од неговото житие. Јас знам само за тамо дека постојат. Ова е еден од празниците, Успение на Пресвета Богородица. Фотографијата е сликана во перспектива, така да стратувањето е изнудено. Иначе е нормален формат. Исто така сакам да ги хуманизирам образите на апостолите и на трите патриарха во вознесувањето на Света Богородица кога оди во небесата. Ова е ласафер, која има 3,5 метра во ширина. Снимокот не е толку квалитетен. Ова е еден дел од процесот на работата во Торонто. Ова е на зидот каде што сакав да направам акатис, химна на Христосовите празници. Да во еден неприкинат тек зборувам за Христос и неговиот живот. Некаде целата композиција е една од најголемите сакрални слики во православието, затоа што изнесува околу 22 метра во должина и некаде висина е околу 3 метра и 80 сантима. Во тој ансамбл ги представувам Христосовите празници, но се обидувам да направам една драматика меѓу внатрешната натнатост на личностите. Да зборувам со чувство, со ликовно чувство за самата библиска приказна. Ова е распјатието на Христос во процес исто на работење. Кога се оди на ден за работа, мал брек, тако велите ви енглезите. Ова е една мала црква во Македонија. Представена е стикање на таваница, на таванот. Навистина, не е така лесно како што изгледа сликарството на мурал, на дзид, на преск. Тоа траже големи знаења. И затоа јас би споменал овде зошто прифатив да има во моето творештво еден сегмент на оваа сакрална традиција. Јас кога човек, како човек сликар кој има претензии и сака да направи нешто амбициозно, решив да се вратам на изворот, да представите зобрати, затоа што вие кога влезете во еден стар храм, ќе видите едни ансамбли, едни огромни прески, каде има до 500 портрета. Тоа е големо градивство, големо творештво. Затоа треба исто така голема сила, големи знаења и предиспониран врз Божии. Поради тоа, за да го избришам комплексот на старите зографии, се прифати да го проучам тоа и да ја опробам мојата сила токму во таа традиционална уметност, а потоа да ја надоградам со едно ново видување. Та тема е уште отворена и уште не сам ја завршил. Овде сакам да ви кажам пак нешто дека ние македонците сме земја на светители. Овде има од Егејска Македонија и они треба да бидат многу погорди од сите други затоа што Егејска Македонија има неколку прекрасни светители, од кои токму е и ова Злата Мегленска. Старите ја знаат територијата како Караджова или Мегленја. Тоа е во 1823 и 4 година е екзекутирана, убиена од турците парче на парче, со големо хереско држење, која не сакала да се потучи, бидејќи била чудесна убава девојка. И овај нениот отпор толку зел замав во меѓународот, била решителна и чиста, жртвувајќи се да ја запази и народноста и верата, и е прогласена од повеќе цркви за светица, а е ставена во македонска носија затоа што тоа е носија на низиното време. Се вика Злата Мегленска. Уште нешто зборува, незиното име е типично македонско име. Нениот култ ние мора да го возобновиме, затоа што има неколку новомаченици во македонската понова историја од турскиот период. Тоа е Свети Ѓорги Кратовец, кој е спален во Софија. Имаме Дриендафил и Спас, спалени се во Солун. Едниот е од Радовиш, другиот е од Костур. Еве една визура која покажува за она што велев за византиската уметност да се зборува, таа зборува. Златото е ставено како една метафизика, да пригорење на свеките и на светлоста, да тоа дава треперење. И неговата племенитост не внесува во една многу гласна, тиха музика во душите, затоа што и фигурите ги пригоди да бидат во човечки раст, така да верникот кој ќе дојде во Свети Климент да има сугестија дека и тоа е составен дел на Христосовата сцена, на библиската сцена која се одбива. Таму некаде е во почетокот крштевањето, потоа е преображение, воскресението Лазарево, влегувањето во Јерусалим и овој распјатието Господово. Ова е еден детај од крштевањето Исусово. Инвенција ја сакам да внесам во таа источна православна традиција инкарнација, да внесам еден аналитски третман на колорот, на боите, да внесам не само покрај психологијата, да внесам едно некои моменти кои се нови и кои се абсолвирани само собствено мој. Но, во исто време, да направам исто така рамотежа со канонот што го бара програмот на самата црква. Ова е една поголема атмосфера, каде се назира таванот со големиот зид. Ќе има уште 4 фигури на таванот, 4 евангелисти, ќе бидат интерпретирани во тонто. Марко, Матеја, Лука, Јован, со своите зодијаци. Тоа тек сега треба да се довршува. Дело од призот на небеската литургија, играта на ангелите. Ова е атмосфера на самата работа. Тоа е мноштво бои. Јас малку ќе кажам како информација и за самата технологија. Ова е прастара технологија, необично тешка, затоа што бара исклучителна концентрираност и на самиот материјал, се работи во пигменти, бој во прав, со јајчена емулзија. Но многу е трајна, која е многу по-трајна од уљеното сликарство, painting oil, затоа што не сиве и го одржува колорот, може би ако не дојде влага, неколку илјади години без промена. Само влага не треба, хигроскопија да не дојде. Тоа е пак Свети Климент во Охрид, престолната икона. Ова е дел од крштевањето на Исус. Увеличена сцена од призо на Воскресење Лазарево, облегување во Јерусалим. Дел од процесот на работата. Свети Петр и Павле се позади. Ова е зашто зборував дека индивидуалниот портрет мора да живее. Затоа што ако не се почитува дека секој портрет да е собствен, се паѓа во, во манир и во разводнетост. Големајстор е тој кој ќе внесе многу карактери, кој ќе компарира повеќе човечки образи, повеќе карактери и тоа во со една племенитост, со, со едно, едно знаење. Ова е воскресение во Воскопската црква на Христос. Снимокот не е квалитетен, бледо делува. Ево, атакистот на Христосовите празници, ова шо велев дека сакав да се придружам во раскажувачката моќна византиската уметност. Таде сцена во сцена, се, тоа е исто ново. Порано старите зоографики обградувале со, со рамови, сцена со сцена. А јас сето тоа го спои во еден континуитет. Така мислам дека по-ликовно ќе живе и дека како една слободна тема е. Злато не е. Уште една атмосфера на био. А ова е истата техника, еден детај од една моја слика, поголема, 8 метра е ова слика, тоа е само еден детај, се вика, овој дел цивилизација се вика сликата, ова е реквиум. Овој дел представува истата техника, тоа е иконска техника на, на, на нови материјали. Тоа е детај каде зборувам за дека во македонската култура постои континуитет. Ова се пријатели мои кои веќе се умрени, тоа е еден голем актер Дарко Даневски. Го представувам овде како зограф. Ова е големиот певец од Пиринска Македонија Георги Божиков. Голем бас и тој веќе сега покоен. Сушност тоа крило на таа слика голема цивилизација е едно, едно сеќавање на нив. Една студија на Александр Македонски се најде во диапозитивите. И тоа е Свети Климент. Јас во кратки црти сакам да кажам дека Македонија е земја која се прижимала со, со цивилизациите и дека таа должи на цивилизацијата, но и цивилизациите, и мислам, и светот должи на Македонија. Ние треба секој пат со пиетет, да, како да мислиме за себе, така и за другите достигања. Може да се попалиме дека нашиот дух е универзален и дека овај во сегашната политичка ситуација со грците, правиот македонец вели, колку што ги знам, мои пријатели прави, тие нека си се за себе, ќе им ги признаеме вредностите, само тие се оштетуват, зашто тие ги замижуват и фалсифицират сите наши овај историски вредности. А нема да згасне тоа што не гасне и дека нити име дава човек, нити име дава политика, име дават небото, Бог и милениумите. Благодарам за вниманието, може некој ме наше. Ако така некој во технолошка смисла или во, да ме праша нека повели. Ти
What Georgi said in the last 40 minutes will probably take me many weeks, if not months, to absorb. He did an overview from the very beginning. He went as far as Ptolemy. I don't know if you ever, if you understood what he talked about there, but he mentioned that somewhere in Egypt they found some, I guess I can call them icons, of the same style, or very close of the icons that were done in more recent times. Because they were done on wood, with cloth, and with a technique or technology very similar to what was done in recent times, let's say on the Balkans. That was quite interesting. I didn't know that myself, so I've learned something today. And I'd like to mention a couple of main points, although it's difficult for me to go back and translate what he said. But he emphasized the fact that it was in Macedonia and the regions around that the Renaissance of Christianity has started. Or maybe we want to call it a second Renaissance.